Hang on. So this poem I wrote for a concert, actually, not very long ago. And I was thinking about how so many people don't necessarily see what's right in front of them. They can't see that there's a God, they can't see that there's more to life. And so I called this poem Freedom in Christ, because a lot of people don't see that there's freedom, and they're trying to find their freedom in so many different areas, and they're not actually finding the freedom that they can only get through Jesus. So, yeah, this is the poem. Hear when they cannot hear, see, nor understand what God has for them in the work of his hands. Perverting their ways, they're misunderstood when good becomes evil and evil is good. You see, the devil comes to do three things: to steal, kill, and destroy. There's no other plan, there's no other ploy. He just comes to entice you through the lust of your flesh, then devours your soul till you have nothing left. So what's holding you? Is it your money or your pride? Because you'll lose all you have in the blink of an eye. See, this world was formed not by you or I, but a living God, intelligent and wise. Because without intelligence, who created the skies or the birds or the trees or the clouds or the mind? But there's a robbery, and it's no longer disguised, but what's in the dark, it will come to the light. But what if I said you were bought with a price? Did you know that God sent his son down to die? Because sin has you in chains. You're resistant to truth. You've accepted the claims and you've rejected the proof. So let's go back to the start. The beginning where Satan entered the heart of man who sowed a seed. Because there was Adam and there was Eve, such intelligent beings, but even they were deceived. Male and female to start. But these days we believe that anything goes, what will be will be. But see, things have a place under heaven and a purpose and means. And a place under heaven, but these days it seems that even gender gets twisted. What was pure and pristine gets perverted in schools and the media, your screens. Because the days are evil and we'll see more and more. Because there's sin at the root and it lies at the door. And there's no other gospel that can save all mankind. It's so simple, it's foolish, confounding the wise, but it's redemption for you and for I. So what is this gospel? Let me share this prize. For although you sin, then we're headed for hell, where the fire is not quenched in the dark, you can tell. A man named Jesus, he cancelled the debt. He defeated the grave and he's God in the flesh. And there's no other gift, there's no other grace. He's the truth and the life, and he died in your place. You can have him today, because tomorrow is not promised. And the God of this earth doesn't want you to perish. Because when Jesus comes back, all eyes will see. Every tongue will confess and will bow at the knee. Because when he comes back as a thief in the night. So don't wait too long to give him your life, because there's freedom in Christ. But I'll let you decide. Thank you.
Amen. If we have our Bibles this afternoon, Matthew 5:14. I've entitled this sermon, Do You Glow in the Dark? Do you glow in the dark? You go, I like that picture, you know. I wonder who made it. I made it myself. Let me just run out there. Do you glow in the dark? I remember, so my wife does a bit of hair, so she's got a little hair business that she does on the side, weekends, now and then, you know. So I remember this one time, she never usually tells me like the conversations that she has with the people that she does her hair with, but she came home one time and she was like to me, oh, I've got something that I want to show you, you know. So jump on the computer. And then we go into YouTube and she shows me a David Attenborough video about birds. There was a male bird that was he was designing his house. So he was making his house look nice, putting sticks here, leaves there and whatnot. And then a female bird comes to his little crib, nest place. he starts performing for her, he starts dancing, starts doing all sorts of things to try and woo her, you know, and then we know what happens there, we know what happens next, but anyway, so it made me think, you know, I'm not really a nature person, you know, but it really made me think, it was quite interesting that a male would do this, or a male bird would go to so much trouble, you know, to try and woo a female bird. And it happens in all walks of nature, you know. Another interesting thing that I came across was a firefly. Everyone knows what fireflies are, yeah? So they're also known as glowworms. So they, the female glowworms, they're the ones that actually have the light in them. So their stomachs actually glow. And if you have a brighter glow than other females, then you're more likely to get attracted by males as a mate, you know. And what was interesting about this is that the female firefly actually has 10 days to find someone to mate with, or they die. And then once they do mate, they have an extra 3 days to lay their eggs. And then before the eggs are even hatched, both the male and the female firefly dies. But the interesting thing, or interesting thought that I caught from this, is that here we have a creature, you know, and at the right time, it begins to glow, yeah. You know, and to carry out its purpose. A creature that God had created at the right time, in the midst of darkness, you know, it begins to glow, to carry out the purpose or the reason why it was created in the first place. You know, when we look out into this world, we see darkness. Yeah. You know, we hear about darkness. Yeah. We feel dark. We can even smell darkness at times. Yeah. You know, and we sense darkness too. But the question that I have for you today is, do you glow in the darkness? Do you glow in the darkness of this world that we walk in? Do you glow? Are you the person that is that bright light in that darkness that you walk in today? Because we as Christians, we've been called for a purpose. We've been called for such a time as this. We've been called, we've been created to glow in the midst of this. You know, we hear, we see in scripture, in Ephesians 5:8, it says, "For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light." You know, we were once dark, but now we have light in the Lord. So we should walk as children of light. Do you glow in the dark? Is the question that I want to ask you today. Matthew 5:14 to 16 says, "You are light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp or put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." You know, verse 16 in the Message version, it says, "Don't hide your light. Let it shine for all. Let your good deeds glow for all to see, so that they will praise your heavenly Father." You know, first I want to talk about the atmosphere of darkness. You know, we are living in an atmosphere of darkness. Yeah. We see it every day, or we hear about it every day in today's society. Yeah. You know, where we can feel, you know, that there is a darkness that is trying to come up against a light. Where we can see, or we can we hear it on the news, or we read it on the news, that there is a darkness that is trying to overcome the light. That there is a light that wants to try and overcome the darkness. And we also see it in scripture. Colossians 1:13, it says, "He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of His love." Yeah. You know, we were rescued from this darkness and brought into light. We were taken from darkness and brought up into light. There was a mission of deliverance that took place there. You know, same again, First Thessalonians 5:5, it says, "You are son of light and son of the day. We are not of the night, nor of darkness. We come across scriptures of light and darkness in the New Testament constantly, you know, referring or we're looking and we're seeing, you know, that we have come from a dark place. We have come from a place of darkness.
Yeah.
You know, we have come from a place where there is no hope, there is no light there. You know, we've been brought to a hope, we've been brought to a light. We have been taken by Jesus and brought to something that is bright. You know, Psalms 119, chapter 199, verse 105 says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." You know, you are either a child of light or a child of darkness.
Yeah.
You know, and if you are a child of light, then you are led by Jesus.
Yeah.
You're led by the light of His word. You're led by the light of His grace. You're led by the light that He has given unto you, so that you may be able to also take people out of them living in darkness and bring them to light, bring them to a place of brightness. 1 John 1 verse 67 says, "If we say that we have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, we lie and we do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin." You know, there's a constant battle that is going on. Constant battle. We can say one thing, we can move one specific way, but the constant battle is, are you a child of the light?
Yeah.
The constant battle is, are you walking in the light? The constant battle is, are you in fellowship with the light? The constant battle is, are you involved in a relationship with the light? You know, because if you are not involved, then you are in darkness. If you are not there in a relationship, then you are in darkness. If you are not walking, then you are in darkness. There is a constant struggle. There is a constant battle there that is going on. Even Paul in Ephesians, he explains, you know, that we do not war against flesh and blood, but we war against principalities, evil rulers of the darkness of this age. There is a darkness that is trying to take our soul. There is a darkness that is trying to take your soul.
Yeah.
A darkness that is trying to overcome your life. A darkness that is trying to take you out. But our scripture that we read earlier says, you are the light of this world. You as a Christian, you are the light of this world. You know, regardless of the struggles that you're going on with inside yourself, you are a light of this world.
Yeah.
The honest question, are you glowing in the darkness? Are you a glowing light in the darkness that you see? Are you a glowing light in the darkness that you see? You know, our mission that He has given unto us, you know, is that we go and seek and save the lost. We go out into the darkness. We go out and we seek and save. We bring people that light. We show people the light that they can't see. You know, I remember when I was in Dublin on the Impact team, you know, I had a tremendous opportunity to pray for a young man. I prayed with him. And as I was talking to him after I prayed with him, I told him, you know, God has so much for you. You know, and I didn't know, I knew what I was saying, you know, but I didn't realize what I was saying, should I say. But as the years went by, the young man came up to me and said, "Oh, I remember you. I remember you. When you said what you said to me, it stuck in my mind." And he said that he had a bet on for $6,000 at that moment there. He said that he should have gone to the betting shop to pick up his $6,000, but he decided to rip up his ticket after he prayed and threw it away.
No.
And he said those words stuck with him simply because he understood that $6,000 could have gone by the time he had seen me 2 years later. But the $6,000 is gone now, forever. But yet he has riches that are restored in heaven. There is something there that has been given unto him that is greater than the $6,000 that he should have won. You know, a relationship with Jesus is that is what he has picked up. To seek and save the lost. In the darkness, they focus just on what they can see. You know, when you get up at night and you're trying to find your senses in the darkness, you can only hold on to the things that are close to you, but you can't see far ahead. But once you switch on that light, you can see where you are going without even trying to touch things around. And that is what Jesus is trying to bring to us, to our attention here today, is that we have a hope. You know, we have something that people want. We have something that people are searching around for. And as we bring it to them, you know, then they will be able to see beyond. They won't need to feel around. They won't need to try things that are not good for them. They don't need to try things that could only last a few moments, but they can see beyond what is in front of them. William Barclay said, Jesus did not say you are light of the church. He said you are light of the world. You know, the real test for us is not how we act when we're in church. Yeah. It's not how we behave when we're in church. It's how do we respond when we are out of church. You know, do we blend in with the darkness? Or do we come out and we stand bold in the light? You know, I remember a few years ago, a lady came to church. And she pointed out a brother, you know, and she said, this guy was chatting me up on Instagram or Snapchat, one of them social media things. He said, this guy was chatting me up, you know, and this guy wasn't just a guy that just recently come to church. He was a man that was leading in ministry. He was involved. You know, if you go to morning prayer, he'll be there praying. If you go to outreach, he'll be there speaking to somebody or praying for somebody. If you go to church, you know he's going to be there. But yet, behind the scenes, he was blending in with the darkness. Behind the scenes, he was trying to push himself into something else. And as he was approached even, you know, he denied it. And then eventually, you know, the messages got brought forth to him. And he held up his hands. And he said, okay, you caught me out. But there was another guy, actually. You know, this young man was also, again, heavily involved in ministry. You know, he was seen as second in line to his pastor. You know, but as the offering was being passed around, you know, and he'd take the bucket, he'd be dipping his hands into the offering and putting it into his pocket. He'd constantly be doing this. Wow. You know, and eventually, again, confronted. You know, and again, denied. Eventually, he got caught out by his wife. And his wife brought forth the evidence to everybody. And again, he said, okay, you caught me out. What a tragedy it is, you know, for people that are out there in the darkness of this world. Yeah. They don't know their way, but people that know the light to lose their glow in the darkness. What a tragedy it is for people to see that they don't understand the light that they're in.
Yeah.
They don't understand the light that they can have or bring to the darkness of this world. Matthew 6:23 says, if therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? How great is the darkness that is in you? How great? You know, the darkness of this age, you know, as it begins to overcome, as it begins to cast over your life, as it begins to take away the glow that you have, you know, how great is that darkness, the scripture is saying. You know, Romans 13:12 says, let us cast off the works of the darkness. Let us put on the armor of light. Let us put on the armor of light. You know, but just like, you know, as I spoke about the firefly, it has its own light. You know, we as Christians here, you know, we are sinful creatures. If you didn't know that, you're a sinful creature. I am too. Yeah, I am a sinful creature too. But the reason why I say that is because we need a light source Not like the firefly. The firefly has its own light source, but we ourselves, we need a light source to help us to find that glow. We need a light source to bring that glow to us.
Yeah.
And that light source, the scripture says in 2 Corinthians 4:6-7, for it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. We have this treasure in the earthen vessel, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. It's not of us that the light comes from, but it's of God. It's of the face of Jesus Christ that the light that shines within us comes from. It's of the face of Jesus Christ where we get the light source to shine in this darkened world. It's of the source of Jesus Christ that we can get the light that we desire, the light that would help us shine in this darkened world. You know, when we are listening to what the scripture is saying, when we're hearing what God is trying to say to us, you know, in this scripture, Acts 4:13, it says, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled and they realized that they had been with Jesus. These men were uneducated, untrained. I remember a pastor actually said, I never went to uni, I didn't even finish school, but he said, I've got a PhD. He said, I'm a Potter's House disciple. We are uneducated, untrained, you know, but yet Jesus Christ can still be seen in us.
Yeah.
You know, Jesus Christ is still seen in him. Jesus Christ is still seen in them. They still have a light source that is seen in them, regardless of who they are, regardless of where they have come from, regardless of what they have done in their lives. The source, the light source is seen in them, which is Jesus Christ. You know, we can look back as well in the time of Moses, when Moses went up into Mount Sinai and then he looked and he spoke to God and he was with God for 40 days and 40 nights, it says. You know, and as he came down, he said his face was glowing. The light, the presence of God that gave him that light. We have a light source that we can obtain here today. We have a light source that we can grasp hold of here today. We have a light source. You know, and maybe you're thinking to yourself, oh, you know, maybe I'm not that light, I'm not that bright. You know, maybe I don't have that light source in me. You know, the things that are in our lives that we can say, you know, this is definitely darkening my life. You know, we can look at our life and we can say, you know, I've made a mistake here and it's made me the way that I am today. I've made a mistake in this way, but it's made me the way that I am today. You know, constantly when we do things on our own, we darken that light. Constantly when we do things, you know, without Christ, we darken that light. Constantly when we say to ourselves, you know, maybe I can just do it, or maybe I can ride through it, we darken our light and we darken what God is trying to bring out in us. You know, our experiences in life will sometimes darken or dampen the light that God is trying to bring in us. But when we step into that presence of God, when we step into the presence, when we begin to understand what the presence of God brings within us, we can begin, or we will continue to grow. We will continue to understand what God is trying to do in our lives. We will continue to understand why God is trying to do what he is trying to do. When he says left, we go left simply because I understand why God is telling me this. I understand, you know, God has a future. God knows I have a future. God wants the best of my future. So I'm going to listen to what he has to say. You know, there was a pastor that went to visit a man that hadn't been to church for some time. And he arrives at the man's house, and the man's in his back garden, and he's just sitting by the fire. You know, the coal is glowing. So he's sitting by the fire, and the man is expecting the pastor to rebuke him, expecting the pastor to say, "What are you doing? Wake up, man. You know, you're messing about. Come back to church." But the pastor just sits down next to him, and what he does, he picks up one of the coals and he takes it out of the fire. And then eventually, you know, I don't know, some 10 minutes, 15 minutes later, the coal just dies out and it goes black. And the man turns to the pastor and he says, "Pastor, I'm going to be in church on Sunday." You know, the reason why the pastor did that is because when we take ourselves away from the fire, when we take ourselves away from the presence of God, our glory begins to darken. When we take ourselves away from the presence of what God is trying to do, our glow begins to darken. We begin to lose that light source. When we're not spending enough time in the presence of God, our glow begins to disappear. And then it begins to go black. It begins to go into that darkness. God has called you to glow where you can be seen. God has called you to glow in your workplaces. God has called you to glow within your family. God has called you to glow within your school. God has called you to glow within the places where there is darkness. God has called you to glow so that you, God can see, so that you can be seen, so that people can look at you and say, "I want that glow.
Yes.
I want that Jesus. I want some of that salvation for me."
Yeah.
You know, God wants to use your life to direct people. God wants to use your life to show people, you know, that there's more to this life than the simply what they are chasing after.
Yeah.
You know, do the people at your workplaces, do the people in your neighborhood, the people in your school, your family members, do they know that you know Jesus? Do they see the light in your life? Do they see the glow in your life? Someone once said that there can be no such thing as a secret discipleship, for either the secrecy destroys the discipleship, or the discipleship destroys the secrecy. We have got to show that light. We have got to show that light, whether it's through your actions. You know, I tend to walk into work and into my workplaces, and I don't tell people I'm Christian, you know, but from the things that I do, from the words that I say, you know, from the banter that I get involved in sometimes as well, you know, they realize that this person's different, that there's something different about him.
Yeah.
You know, the amount of times that I've been asked, you know, "There's something different about you. What is it? You know, do you go to church? Are you a Christian?" The amount of times I've been asked those simple questions, just simply because they can see that there's something about my life.
Yeah.
There's something different about you. Can that be the same for you as well? Is there something different about you when you sit amongst your friends? Is there something different about you when you're in your school and people are throwing cuss words out and people are cussing different people? Is there something different about you when you're at your workplaces? Is there something different about you?
Yeah.
You know, of our main text in verse 15, it says, "Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house." You know, recently me and my wife, we went to pray for a lady at her house, and she was just telling me loads of different things. You know, the struggles that she's been going through, the presence that she's feeling in her house, loads of different things that she was bringing up. And you know, we said, "We're going to pray for you." You know, we just prayed for her to receive salvation. We prayed for a presence, a darkened presence in her household as well. And the days before, she had been complaining about her chest having issues. We didn't pray for that. We didn't pray for healing. But moments later, she says, "I can breathe now." There has been a light that has been transpired, not just through her believing, but just through the prayers that have been given off. There's been a light that's been transpired
into her. Now she can see the light. It says, all who are in the house will see the light. All who are in the house, all who are in the presence of God will see the light. All who are in the presence of God will understand, will see what God is trying to do. You know, there is a reason why God wants us to not hide our light. There is a reason why God wants us to show how bright He is shining in our life. It is so that other people can meet Him, so that other people can be healed, so that other people can come out of this darkened state, so that other people can walk in the light too. A man named Guy Kings once said, the darkest place needs the brightest light. You know, we can look and we can tell, I can tell so many stories about people that are struggling out in the world. You know, work friends, families. I'm sure we are in that same boat as well. We can tell us so many different stories about people that are struggling. You know, but we have the brightest light. We have the brightest, we can bring the brightest light to their darkest places. We can bring that light to their places where they have no sense of direction. Where they have no sense of what is going to happen next. Where they have no sense of, you know, is there hope in this situation? We can bring a light. We can bring a light to what struggles or issues that they are going through. You know, I remember, like I said, I'm not a person of nature. But, for some reason, or recently, I've been watching nature. My boss, he's really into trees, really into different sorts of natural stuff. You know, him being brought up in Trinidad, I understand. You know, he was brought up around nice sort of nature. When you come to England, it's not that nice sort of nature. But anyway, yeah. But he was brought up around different things. And I remember him taking a plant home, actually. You know, I've been working at my workplace for 4 weeks now. So he took a plant home in my first week. This plant looked dead. No word of a light, it looked absolutely finished. He brings it back 4 weeks later and it looked alive. Wow. I said, is this the same plant? He said, yes. Wow. It's the same plant and it is sharp. Wow. You know, and what I realized, or what the thought that came from this, is that in life, you know, we go through different seasons where we have our ups, we have our downs. You know, when we look out into the world, you know, we can see trees where leaves are going to start to fall off. You know, leaves are going to start to change color, and then in the summer again they shoot out again. In the summer again we'll see the green leaves. In the summer again we'll see them as tall as ever. You know, we go through different seasons in life, but our light has to continue shining in those different seasons. Because it's in our nature, when we feel or when we see something good, you know, we will share it. When we will show it to other people. But God is saying, you know, even in your hardest moments, you know, show your light. Even in the darkest moments, show your light. Because it's in your nature to shine. The glowing in the dark is all about people seeing God. Glowing in the dark is all about people understanding, you know, that this life isn't forever and that there is a hope beyond this life, and that is Jesus. Verse 16 of our scripture says, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Through the light that we have, you know, we will be able to show, we will be able to glorify our Father in heaven, and people will be able to see, people will be able to glorify our Father in heaven. We have to reflect the light that God wants to shine into this world. Amen. Yes, we see darkness. Yes, we feel darkness. Yes, we can even smell darkness, as I said earlier. But the light that we have to show it in this darkened world. For God to really be glorified. For God for us to lead people to Christ. Yes. With that, can every head bowed and every eye closed. Just in respect to God,
in respect to your neighbor, just every head bows and every eye closed.